Oh, Angie and what's her face? Peggy.
It is a Boston type marriage, but a Boston marriage used to have a lot of connotations too, right?
Absolutely. I think why not? I fully support that idea. I think that's a great idea. It's a very modern notion. I think relationships are so much more interesting and complex and grey area than we like to kind of portray in the media. I think they're a lot more richer and fuller, whether there is a romantic element to them or not. So I think, I think that Angie and Peggy are kind of ahead of their time in the way that they're kind of modern women living in the 1940s in what's essentially a man's world and trying to make it. But I think that, Lindsay plays her so brilliantly, and there's a real affection Lindsay and I have for each other as two actresses working together. And that's something that I've tried to have with every actor that's come in, even if they've only got one scene to play in the show, because it's essentially my show and I'm leading it. I'm leading the tone and the atmosphere on set. So I want to make sure that anyone that comes in just for a day or 2 days feels validated, feels welcomed, feels appreciated, and as a result, they do their best work because of it. So I'm very keen on forging important professional working relationships that seem to spill over onto the screen and just tell a stronger, better story. I've gone off onto a random tangent, but there you go.
Wondering what your reaction was to when you saw older Peggy in Ant-Man on screen.
I haven't seen it. I know, I'm sure it's crushing the box office, the fact that I haven't paid my ticket yet, but I will go and see it. I've got a photograph, and obviously I was there, so I know, I look like. I love it. I think she looks great. She's got really good hair. And I'm like, God damn it, I can't get my hair to do that by myself. So I'm just hoping that I age as gracefully as Peggy. I'm gonna have to hire a permanent hairdresser really to do that. But I think she ages well. She's pretty well.
Hi, Haley.
Hello.
You have some great dialogue on the show, so I wanted to know what your favorite Agent Carter quote is.
It's really hard, because every time I learn lines, as soon as I've delivered them, I can't remember them again. I obviously, the quote of I know my value, anyone else's opinion doesn't really matter, is something that I've seen so many people with the tattoos of that quote, which is very moving. And it's, and I think that really sums up who Peggy is and who she discovers herself to be towards the end of the first season. And also, it reveals that her agenda, the reason why she's doing this, she's carrying on this work, not for the fame, not for the praise, not for this kind of social status, but for the labor itself, for the fulfillment of doing the job to the best of her ability, because she knows who she is. And I think that's such a strong and such a positive and inspiring place to be, rather than a kind of a desperate need to be validated by other people. It's like, well, it doesn't really matter. It doesn't really matter what people think of you. In fact, it's actually none of your business. The most important thing is what you think of yourself. And that's something that Peggy has in spades, which is why she can walk into a room and not be intimidated by the men. And she's not focusing on her insecurities about being in an environment like that. And it means it's more headspace for her to focus on the witty retorts, the clever comebacks, devising intelligent plans. Because she's got more headspace, because she's focusing on the right things rather than focusing on, oh my God, no one's saying I'm amazing. No one's giving me credit. No one's slapping my ass. Yeah. I feel like she's suddenly Americanized that. Really sorry. I'm just telling you if there are any Americans here. I hope that kind of answers your question.
Hi, Haley.
Hi.
My question is, may you please compare how you reacted to the first episode of Agent Carter, so when you were reading the script, to how you reacted when you were reading the script for the finale?
Well, the great thing was they were kind of writing it as they went along, so I didn't have all the scripts at once. I was having the next episode given to me a couple of days before we started filming it, so it was very fresh. I think what I loved was the arc of Steve. and how that manifests in, you know, the, obviously the getting his, having a vial of his blood and making sure it doesn't get into the wrong hands and doubting Howard and all these things that are happening. But also, ultimately, personally, it's a story about her grief. And it's how she overcomes that and how she manages to move on. And how she also at the same time manages to protect the memory of Steve by destroying his blood, destroying any kind of evidence so it doesn't get into the wrong hands. And I just thought it was very beautiful and very sensitive because I think so many people who saw Captain America loved Steggy, as they call it, Peggy and Steve, and they loved that relationship. So I think if we'd gone straight into the first season with a new love interest, I think it would have undermined what they had together in the first season. So it was very important that they established what the loss of him did to her and the fact that she still tries to carry on his work throughout the season. And then I think it was just beautifully wrapped up because, you know, I think people can move on, and it's part of human nature to, once you've processed something very painful and something like loss, that there is hope for you to be able to not ever replace that person, but to certainly kind of make way for a new opportunity in your life that gives you greater contentment and companionship. So that's what we're exploring with the second season.
First off, I don't care what the titles on these badges say. Peggy wasn't the Dub Smash winner. Coulson wasn't the Dub Smash loser. As to my question...
Wait, what did you say? You said, I'm not a winner and he's not a loser.
Very nice. As to the question...
No, I really don't understand what you're saying, mate.
As to the question, do you have planned out what you're going to have Clark and Chloe do in the odd event that you win the Dub Smash War? I mean, you may as well... You may as well tell us.
Yeah, he's dressed up. I mean, considering we're going to win, I should have thought this through by now. I don't know. I mean, I think what we'll end up doing, honestly, is... I can't read that, sorry. I haven't got my glasses on. I can't see it, sorry. But you look fabulous. Anyway, we're going to carry on and answer your conversation. I think that because there's going to be something... There's going to be a generosity of spirit. You know, Clark and Chloe are wonderful people and great people to be able to work with. And James and I feel that it was because it was Clark's idea to raise money for charity that we should keep the feel, this whole feel of this generosity of spirit and how this kind of tongue-in-cheek, let's tease each other, but ultimately we're doing this for a good cause. And it's because it's a lot of fun. And, you know, sitting there thinking, oh God, what's Clark going to come up with next? And, oh my God, we got that. Brilliant, we're going to nail him. All of those things. But I think that this, I don't want to punish them too much when they lose. I think we'll do something like, we'll do a Dub Smash where we're all kind of together as a family or something. You know, I think that we don't want to take it too far and end up causing kind of negativity. They're going to hate me when I win, but I want to keep the spirit alive, which is one of generosity and creative fun.
And we've already planned out what we're going to do for the next two videos.
We've already filmed the second one.
It's mine.
Yeah, we're coming up for the finale.
And no other hints or...
No, sorry.
No hints or anything about the second one?
I'd have to kill you.
Okay. No hints!
Hi.
Hi.
So my question is that in the first season of Agent Carter, Peggy's really inspired by Steve and he's kind of like a role model of it. But who are the female role models in Peggy's life?
That's a very good question. Probably not many, actually. Really not many. I mean, she's self-made. We're going to explore a little bit about her background. If we went to season three, we'd probably explore a little bit more. I think because it's so unusual for a woman of that time, in that situation, to have the qualities that Peggy has, I think she was probably more influenced by the men in her life, and certainly maybe there's a mention of a brother and probably her father, who I assume has a military background, so it's in her blood. And I think that she was also brought up to believe and to be taught that she was just as good as the men and just as capable. And that comes, very importantly, comes from men in her life telling her that. I certainly had it, you know, when I was growing up, my dad was more inclined to tell me that I was smart rather than I was pretty. And I think that kind of served me well because it meant that I didn't use my feminine looks as my main currency. I looked to develop other aspects of my personality, which I think is essential as an actor to do that. And I think kind of Peggy's similar. I think she had probably a very stern but understanding father who believed that she could do anything. And a brother that probably teased her enough until she knew how to stand up to him. And then, you know, that's why Angie's so important in her life. Angie's probably the first woman that she's met that she can relate to but can start to confide in. So, but we'll see how it evolves. It's a question for the writers, really, and how they want to explore Peggy.
You work with such an amazing cast on Agent Carter, so I was wondering what's been the most memorable moment on set for you?
Oh my goodness me. Well, there's been, you know, everyone that's come on set know that they're coming onto a very happy set. Especially now that we're in our second season, we all know each other incredibly well. So there's an ease and a, you know, it's a very relaxed, chilled out atmosphere, as well as a commitment and a focus to getting the work done in the best that we can. But I'm going to have to say that it's to do with James and Dominic, really, who I've known for like the last 10 years back in England, and they're such silly billies, and they're, you know, James is this absolutely heart of gold, and I can make him do anything, which is really good fun. He's also great at reacting to pranks. I know that I've posted a couple of videos recently of people jumping out at him and him just going apeshit. Sorry! Sorry, what's my leverage? And it's really entertaining. Dominic as well is just, I have this, actually maybe I might post it actually. I've got this video of, we filmed a few days in Universal last season, and I have this video of him pretending he's the Doc from Back to the Future, because we went onto the Universal lot where they have the clock, and he's like, okay, Marty, and he does this whole little sketch, and this was really cute, and I might post it. I'll have to ask him if naturally I'll just post it. It's really, really cute, but you'll get a sense of just the silliness that we have. I don't know if anyone saw it, I posted recently a Jarvis dancing, like a little pelvic thrust, which just entertains me to no end. Because you're just, you know, when you're working the hours that we work, and there's an element of this pressure, of course, you're working with a big, incredibly loved and well-respected institution like Disney and Marvel, there's a responsibility that comes with it, and a level of professionalism that needs to really set the bar high. And you need to be on your game. You need to know exactly what you're doing and make creative choices. But in order to do my best work, I have to have an equal amount of downtime with the people that I'm working with that is fun. So we goof around a lot, because I think it actually makes us work better and makes us work harder when the camera's actually rolling. So there'll be a lot more silly stunts that you'll see as the season goes on, and silly pranks. And any recommendations and suggestions, please let me know. I'll do my best to do them, to bring them into fruition.
Hi Peggy. I called you Peggy because I'm kind of nervous. You are honestly one of my role models, and you're like perfect. Okay, so my question is, do you think Peggy would come out as a victor in the Hunger Games?
She seems like a very grounded, good, solid person that I'd like to get drunk with. So many times.
I mean, I was singing I'm Just a Sweet Transvestite when I was 7.